So approach to hernia, it is said that inguinal hernia, which is most common in the human, is price being paid by mankind for the erect posture. Hernia, especially inguinal hernia, is not present in the animal so often. It is rare in the animal because they are four-footed. So due to that, their external and internal ring doesn't come in the same gravity line. But in the human, because of erect nature, external and internal ring comes into the same gravity, and that's why inguinal hernia is one of the most common hernia which occurs in the human. And same in the chimpanzee also, it is found. History, in India, surgery started 800 years before the Jesus Christ. At that time, there was a lot of castration and infection due to the injury of the bowel and others. In 19th century, Edoardo Bassini, one Italian surgeon, has given the first concept of the Bassini repair of the hernia. And then, in 1987, the Gear has performed laparoscopic, and in 1983, Estopa has given the tension-free repair of hernia. That is by the Estopa peritalization technique. Classification, already we know, hernia can be classified according to site, according to the occurrence, according to the clinical. Site is inguinal, femoral, espalasian, ventral, hiatal, lumbar, occurrence, primary, recurrent, and incisional. And according to clinical, it may be reducible, irreducible, obstructed, or strangulated. Treatment of hernia is as old as history of medicine. In the old time, people were using the metal truss. And the idea was to keep a pressure over the defect so that abdominal wall will remain supported. Today also, companies are making these type of plastic truss, and the purpose is to support the external ring. But this type of conservative treatment has a lot of complication. Sometimes it can create strangulation, sometimes infarctions. So that's why conservative is seldom indicated. Conservative management of hernia should only be reserved for the people who cannot tolerate any type of surgical interference. Surgery is the only option, either open or laparoscopy. Truss. You want to truss for the precaution? Precaution means preventive. Preventive, I don't know. In my opinion, it is not good because it will make the muscle more weak. Because if it has the tendency to get supported, then the elasticity of the muscle will become more lax. So I don't think that there is any role of using the truss as a preventive measure. Although in many situations, increase in the intra-abdominal pressure is if one of the reason, because of the polycystic kidney or severe ascites or any other problem, then in those situations it may be preventive. So that once the pathology is gone, pathology is cured, then again you can remove the truss. But in normal patient, if the defect has once occurred, it has to be repaired. And surgery is the only option, either open or laparoscopy. Laparoscopy, two types you can do. Either totally extraperitoneal or transabdominal preperitoneal. In both of the circumstances, you have to go preperitoneal. But in TAPP, you will always remain preperitoneal. Your entry itself will be preperitoneum. Your entry itself will be preperitoneum, you will enter. And in the TAPP, what is required that you will first go to the preperitoneum. First go inside the abdomen and then you go preperitoneum. So in those situations, you have the much better outcome, and you can consider TAPP nowadays easier to perform. In old time, people were doing more TAPP. And if you see the old literature which is more than before 2000, then it was method of choice. Totally extraperitoneal hernia surgery was considered as method of choice. Why? You are not going inside the abdomen. You can do under a spinal. You are not putting a varus needle. There is no chance of injury of the aorta or vena cava. you don't have the a lot of fear of hypercarbia and decrease in venous return, decrease in tidal volume. These problems are not there in the tip. But slowly it was realized that tip is not a complete surgery. Because in tip, you are working in a very restricted space. And you cannot perform all type of hernia with the tip. Like if it is Ritter's hernia, if it is sliding hernia, if it is pantaloon hernia, or if it is a complete inguinoscrotal hernia, then the tip is difficult. And in those situations, if you will reduce the sac, you can breach the peritoneum, and if the peritoneum is breached, again gas enters into the abdomen, your working space is lost, and once the working space is lost, you are struggling with a lot of hematoma, a lot of seroma. That's why people slowly started leaving the tip, and again TAPP has become slowly more popular because the fear of access technique, injury of aorta, vena cava, bobble, and other complications has reduced drastically after the experience of the surgeon. And in the TAPP, you can perform almost all type of inguinal hernia. And especially nowadays, as I have discussed before, that IPOM technique can be performed with much easy technique, which you can do in the TAPP only. In the tip, IPOM is not possible. Laparoscopic surgeons, they give Pascal principle of hydrostatic pressure in their support. If you have a bathtub, and if there is an opening of the bathtub, and if you want to put a stopper of the bathtub, you can put two way, either from within or from outside. If you put the stopper of the bathtub from inside, then with increasing pressure of the water, it will fix more firmly. And there is no chance of dislodgement. But if you put the stopper of the bathtub from outside, with increasing pressure of the water, it may dislodge. Exactly same way, if this is the abdominal wall, and here is a viscous pressure, then in open surgery, we put the mesh from outside. And in laparoscopy, we put the mesh always from within. So once the fibrosis develops, it fixes more firmly and chances of recurrence is less. In British Medical Journal 2003 May issue, there was one publication that is a 5-year randomized controlled trial in which it is written that open herniography resulted in more complication than laparoscopic approach. And laparoscopy has less complication than open. But again, I will tell you, this is 2003. If you will do the review of the article before 2000, then you will see there were a lot of criticism against the laparoscopic hernia. Open hernia was considered method of choice. And still, if you will ask the surgeons all over your surrounding, then majority of the surgeons, they don't advocate laparoscopic hernia repair as a gold standard. They still prefer open. But after 2000, once the good quality of tacker started, absorbable implant started coming in the market, you have the glue, fibrin glue, a different type of prosthesis, like omega-3 fatty acid treated mesh, proceed mesh, dacron mesh, vipro mesh, Gore-Tex mesh, polyurethane mesh, and biological mesh. Then slowly popularity of the hernia started increasing. And that's why now slowly hernia surgery is a good to perform by laparoscopy. And because experience of laparoscopic surgeon has also increased, suturing knotting technique is also increased. So now hernia surgery is accepted worldwide as a good procedure to perform by laparoscopy. It is not the same which was 10 years ago. And you can easily perform laparoscopic hernia. Advantage is, it is tension-free repair that reinforces the entire myopectineal orifice. You don't have to do any herniorrhaphy. You don't have to pull the aponeurosis with the inguinal ligament, tie the knot or reduce the sac. And even if it is a multiple hernia, like direct, indirect, femoral together, with one big mesh you can reinforce the entire myopectineal orifice and then surgery is finished, because it is more physiological. The mesh which you are putting, it once it develops fibrosis through the net of the mesh, it makes a separate layer of neodectus, and that will completely reinforce the structure. Chances of recurrence is very less. Less tissue at dissection, less pain, less complication, and early return to work. These are the advantages of the laparoscopic approach. If hernia is bilateral and if hernia is recurrent, then undoubtedly laparoscopy is method of choice. There is no question about that. Most of the authors all over the world, they consider bilateral inguinal hernia surgery as method of choice. Do you know why? In bilateral, if you will do open surgery, you have to give the incision either side. But in laparoscopy with three port, you can perform the surgery of either side, and the cost of surgery also doesn't increase. Suppose this is mesh. What you have to do, fold the mesh fourfold, and then cut the mesh here. Throw this out. Open it. It will become like a butterfly. After that, fold it. Tie one knot here, one knot here, and drop into the abdomen. This is one hernia, this is another hernia. Now you dissect either side, but don't dissect the peritoneum in between. Dissect this side, dissect that side, and then you go from below, put it like that, and then unroll it. And once you unroll, it becomes just like a bow tie. And here it is, supporting like this. You don't have to use any tacker. You just leave it and then close the peritoneum. Surgery finished. Do you know why? The mesh of this side will not allow it to go other side. And this side will not allow it to go. It will say it will go, both will go, otherwise nobody will go. Isn't it? It is too big to migrate. If you use the unilateral hernia surgery, if you have a small mesh, and if you use unilateral, you have to suture it, you have to apply tacker, otherwise it will drop. But in bilateral, you know, for unilateral hernia surgery in India, we charge approximately 60,000 rupees. 60,000 rupees for unilateral hernia. That is approximately $1,000. And if we do the bilateral, we charge same, 60,000 only. Do you know why? Tacker is not used in the bilateral. Only little bit mesh is bigger, and that is some pure proline mesh. That doesn't significantly increase the cost. Cost will increase only 1,000 extra, but you are saving 18,000, the cost of tacker. That's the reason many surgeons all over the world, they always do bilateral surgery. Even if it is hernia is one side, they dissect either side. And in their opinion, that hernia, if it is one side, there is a fair chance to develop to the other side also, contralateral side also. So why not to repair and use a big mesh and reinforce the other side also, that in the future the patient should not go for the again re-surgery.
Sir, pure prolination, does it cause the bowel adhesions?
No, this is TAPP. You have to suture by the peritoneum. And peritoneum is the best known adhesive barrier, isn't it? Once you are covering the peritoneum, you don't have to spend money in any of the expensive mesh. So that's why bilateral is gold standard. Undoubtedly, in any textbook if you take, and if they are describing the laparoscopic hernia repair, they say, okay, for bilateral I am agree that laparoscopic. If even for unilateral they are not very much convinced, but for bilateral they will allow that, yes, it is good. For recurrent, laparoscopy is gold standard. If already open surgery has been performed before, and outside anatomy is fibrotic, disrupted, and again I am cutting the same dead tissue and putting the same repair, chances of again recurrence is much high. But inside anatomy is completely fine, and we are reinforcing the entire myobacterial orifice. We don't do any dissection of the defect itself, and we don't do any suture. So laparoscopy is much better for recurrent hernia. If it is femoral hernia, multiple hernia and primary inguinal hernia, then this is up to you. You can do also, you cannot do also. Patient will have benefit also, patient will not have a lot of benefit compared to open surgery. It is up to you. Whatever you think you are more comfortable, you can do. But if it is bilateral and recurrent, even if you don't do laparoscopy, you should send the patient to a surgeon who do laparoscopy. Contraindications are massive scrotal hernia. Laparoscopy is not good, because a lot of seroma can develop, and in those situations, mismigration is also possible. Patient comes with a huge scrotum, that much big. In India sometime, comes all the intestine is inside. Those cases are not good. Non-reducible incarcerated inguinal hernia also, laparoscopy is not indicated. If it is prior laparoscopic herniography is performed, then again making pre-peritoneal space can be made only one time. The pocket in the pre-peritoneum you can make only one time. Once you have made a pocket in pre-peritoneum and put a mesh and then suture or fix it, now there is a fibrosis with the mesh and with the muscle and with the peritoneum. So all is making a single sheath. Now can you make a pre-peritoneal again? Not possible. Only IPOM technique you can do. If you want, intra-peritoneal only mesh repair can be performed. But doing the TAPP and TAPP is very difficult. So this is a contraindication. And if your prior lymph node dissection or prior groin irradiation is performed for any purpose, like for any cancer or prostate or any iliac lymph nodes, and lymphadenectomy is performed, then again the same thing, fibrosis develop in pre-peritoneal area. And if irradiation is received by the patient, suppose the patient is a female with a cervical cancer and she got irradiation or lymphadenectomy, and then you want to, and she developed hernia and you want to do laparoscopy, it is not good. It is a contraindication. This is a recommendation by Society of American Gastrointestinal Endosurgeon. According to the SAGE's recommendation, if patient is fit for GA and if it is hernia is bilateral or recurrent, then LS means laparoscopic surgery. Laparoscopy is method of choice for bilateral and recurrent hernia. If it is unilateral, then LS or OS, either laparoscopic surgery or open surgery, it is up to you. It is up to you what you want. And if it is strangulated, then only open surgery. No role of laparoscopy.
It's irreducible, sir.
Pardon?
Irreducible, but not strangulated or obstructed.
If it is reducible, then all the hernia should be reducible, isn't it? Then only you can do laparoscopy. No, in the during the clinical examination itself, patient comes to you. You tell the patient to lie down and reduce it. Then and there, if it is reducing in front of you, that means it is reducible. Or if the patient is saying, you should not believe on the patient saying. You should reduce yourself. And if you are not able to reduce it, you should consider it non-reducible. And if it is non-reducible hernia, then there is a way to do laparoscopy, that clock position, you can cut the ring and then you can try to pull the content. But ideally, you should be very experienced, and it is a relative contraindication. If the patient is unfit for GA, then TAPP can be performed in the spinal also. Because in totally extrapetal hernia surgery, we don't go into the abdominal cavity, so that patient will be comfortable even in a spinal anesthesia. Because gas is not pressing the diaphragm, gas is not irritating the diaphragm, soldier tip pain will not be there, venous return will not decrease. But if it is a big hernia, and if you do by a spinal, there is a fair chance that peritoneum will breach. And once the peritoneum will breach and gas enters into the abdominal cavity, and if the patient is under a spinal, then it will give a lot of discomfort to the patient. So large hernia under a spinal cannot be performed by laparoscopy. Better to go by open surgery. And there is no role of laparoscopy under local anesthesia. If your patient cannot tolerate even the spinal, even in the general, and if you are planning to do in the local, then only open surgery is recommended. So this is how you will select the patient for laparoscopy. Now anatomy. Anatomy is the most important thing which we have to keep in mind. And the anatomy of the laparoscopic hernia repair, you know, there are 9 important structures in the pelvis. As soon as you enter for any pelvic surgery, either you want to do the TLH, or you want to do the LAVH, or you want to do the prostate, or you want to do any hernia, or salpingostectomy, after entering into the pelvis, immediately identify the 9 important landmarks, and then start the surgery. So that it will help you to prevent the injury of the major vessels, and it will give you the good landmark and the guide and key landmark for your area of dissection. What are those 9 important structures? The 3 false ligament, 3 true ligament, and 3 dangerous area is there. What are the 3 false ligament? First false ligament is median umbilical ligament. That is in the midline at 12 o'clock position, and this is also called as obliterated urethrus. Actually, it is very faint. In some cases, patients it is obvious, but many of them it is very faint, which was joining the bladder of the baby with the umbilical cord of the mother in the fetal life and got obliterated in adult. This is only 1 in number. And it is at 12 o'clock position in the midline. This is called as median umbilical ligament. Camera of the telescope should be held in such a way, this is the duty of the camera person, that median umbilical ligament should always be at 12 o'clock position during entire hernia surgery. After that, you have 2 medial umbilical ligament, one left, one right side. Medial umbilical ligament is the most prominent peritoneal fold of the lower anterior abdominal wall. What is the most prominent fold of peritoneum of the upper anterior abdominal wall? Falciform ligament. And in the lower anterior abdominal wall, it is 2 medial umbilical ligament. So whatever the maximum fold you are saying, you can easily recognize that this is a medial umbilical ligament. And medial umbilical ligament is two in number. One right, another is left. It is a actually the obliterated umbilical artery, which was present in the fetal life, get obliterated. But remember, if the patient has a portal hypertension, it may recanalize also. In severe portal hypertension. So severe portal hypertension can be considered as a contraindication of doing laparoscopy. So this is the medial umbilical ligament. After medial, third, lateral umbilical ligament. Lateral umbilical ligament is a small, faint, peritoneal, bluish fold lateral to the medial umbilical ligament that contain inferior epigastric vessel. So these are three false ligaments. Why false ligament? Because it is not a true ligament. There is no like ligament like tissue inside this. This is basically a peritoneal fold. This is a peritoneal fold, but because it looks like ligament, that's why we are saying ligament. So this is median, medial and lateral. This is on the anterior abdominal wall. After that, there are three dangerous areas and three true ligament. Let us first discuss the three true ligament. First true ligament is inguinal ligament, which starts from the pubic tubercle and goes up to the anterior superior iliac spine. This is inguinal ligament. This is inguinal ligament. And second true ligament is Cooper ligament. Cooper ligament starts from pubic tubercle and enters into the iliopubic tract. It is also called as lighthouse. It is pearly white in color. And as soon as you will reflect it, it starts as soon as you cut the peritoneum and go to this area, it reflects the light just like a lighthouse which is seen by the sailors in the sea. In the sea, in the dark, everything is dark. But on the seaport, they keep a lighthouse. So that shipman can see that lighthouse and they can recognize, I have to go there. So exactly same way, this is the attracting you once you dissect as a lighthouse. This is Cooper ligament. This is very important because your first fixation of the mesh on the inferomedial margin of the mesh is fixed at Cooper ligament. Third ligament is lacunar ligament, that is a small ligament in between inguinal and Cooper joints. That is very faint ligament, this is lacunar, which is hardly visible. If you go very near, you can see. So these are three true ligaments which comes in your view. Sometimes these Cooper ligament and inguinal ligament, without cutting the peritoneum, with the tip of your grasper, you can feel it also. And it will give you a little tactile feedback. And sometime in very thin patient or pediatric patient, peritoneum is transparent and it is visible directly through the peritoneum. But in obese patient, you cannot directly, peritoneum is not transparent in the obese patient. It has little fat, so you cannot see, you can feel it. There are three dangerous areas. First dangerous area is triangle of doom. Doom word means impending death, fear of death. If you do something wrong here, patient may die, we can lose the patient. So that's why it is called as triangle of doom. The apex of the triangle of doom is deep ring. The medial boundary of triangle of doom is round ligament and lateral boundary is a spermatic vessel. Samson's artery, because round ligament and a spermatic vessel cannot be together. So in the female, medial boundary is round ligament and lateral boundary is Samson's artery, that is the artery which supply the round ligament. And in the male, medial boundary is vas deferens and lateral boundary is spermatic vessel. What it contains is external iliac artery and external iliac vein. External iliac artery and external iliac vein. So this is a very big problem, that if you accidentally pricked this area by needle, or accidentally you fire your tracker this area, isn't it? Or with the harmonic tip you have knocking that area, touch the corner of the tip of the harmonic, has touched it, punctured the vessel. Very difficult patient, you may lose the patient. There may be chances of mortality also. That's why it is called as triangle of doom. Another triangle is called as triangle of pain. The apex of the triangle of pain is deep ring. The lateral boundary is inguinal ligament and medial boundary is spermatic vessel or triangle of doom. Medial to the triangle of pain is triangle of doom. So apex is deep ring, lateral boundary is inguinal ligament and medial boundary is spermatic vessel. And base is made up of reflected peritoneum. On the right side there may be paracolic gutter and cecum and appendix. On the left side there will be sigmoid colon and the paracolic gutter again. So this is triangle of pain. Triangle of pain, why it is so? Because it has two nerves. One is LFCN, another is GFN. LFCN means lateral femorocutaneous nerve of thigh. And LFCN is supplying the lateral aspect of the upper lateral thigh skin and skin around the hip joint. So suppose you have applied some cautery there, or you fire one tacker over the nerve, or a lot of hook you have used to dissect and you have cut the one nerve, then patient will have the scratching, burning, abrasion like pain on the skin there. Even the trouser, if it touch, any garment, if it touch, patient has severe paraesthesia. Patient comes to you, doctor, hernia is okay, but I don't know why this is big problem. And you will say, it must have scratched somewhere, you know. But if patient is clever, if see the internet, go to that. So what you have to give is the Tegretol or Magitol, carbamazepine 200 mg thrice daily. Those are working very good on the neuralgic pain. Magitol you can give. There are two type of nerve injury which I will discuss later during the complication of hernia surgery. I will discuss in the same presentation at the end. So this is the triangle of pain. We should not invite this complication. Another problem is trapezoid of disaster. This is trapezoid of disaster. Just medial to the triangle of pain, there is trapezoid shape, that is corona mortis, and aberrant obturated vessel, that is same. And this has a anteriorly inguinal ligament, medially lacunar ligament, and inferiorly Cooper ligament or iliopectineal tract. So it makes a shape of a trapezoid, and it is, if you will fire your tacker in this area, or if you take a deep bite or something, then patient aberrant obturated vessel, and this corona mortis vein doesn't have wall, and aberrant obturated vessel is joining the obturated vessel with the inferior epigastric vessel, and it doesn't have wall, so it bleeds from either side, inferior epigastric side and obturator side. So you have a problem. So that's why below the inguinal ligament you have three dangerous areas: triangle of doom, triangle of pain, and trapezoid of disaster. Below the inguinal ligament, extreme lateral is okay and extreme medial is okay. Below the inguinal ligament, extreme medial will be what? Pubic tubercle, Cooper ligament and lacunar ligament. That is fine. And extreme lateral also, nerve doesn't come at this point. But in between here, this is the not area where you can fire the tacker, not the area where you can fix the mess, except fibrin glue. You can use glue, but you cannot even take a bite, because accidentally if your needle has pricked the vein, bleeding starts. Above the inguinal ligament, you have only one dangerous area. What is this? Inferior epigastric vessel. Otherwise, you can fire your tacker anywhere. This is rectus abdominis muscle. You can fire. This is arc of transversus abdominis muscle. You can fire tacker as many as you want. Nothing will be a problem. Only you should not fire directly over the inferior epigastric vessel. So this is how the anatomy is identified. Then this is the sacral promontory. This is the median sacral vessel. This is the aortoiliac axis. This is the common iliac vessel. Here is the ureter. Do you know this is the sacral anterior longitudinal ligament where we have fixed the mess that day for sacrocolpopexy. But median and only on right side here. 5 cm above this sacral promontory, this is aortoiliac axis. This is vena cava. This is cecum. This is appendix. Here is the uterosacral ligament of the uterus, ovarian ligament, fallopian tube, round ligament.
The base of triangle 2?
Base of the again reflected peritoneum. That is a peritoneal reflection. If it is in female, it will come in fundilopelvic ligament. In the male, it is a reflected peritoneum. Peritoneal base is formed.
The lateral border is?
For triangle of doom. No. Lateral border is aspermatic vessel. Aspermatic vessel. In the female, there is a artery, Samsung artery. So this is again coming. This is median umbilical ligament. This is medial umbilical ligament. This is lateral umbilical ligament. This is deep ring. And what is this? Vast difference. This is aspermatic vessel. This is inguinal ligament. This is Cooper ligament. This is lacunar ligament. This is aberrant obturated vessel. Isn't it? And this is extra-iliac artery, extra-iliac vein. This is triangle of doom. So apex of triangle of doom is deep ring. The medial boundary is vas. Lateral boundary is aspermatic vessel. And this is triangle of pain. Lateral boundary is inguinal ligament. Medial boundary is aspermatic vessel. And it contains GFN and LFCN. LFCN is lateral femoral cutaneous nerve of thigh, and GFN is genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. And this is trapezoid of disaster. Anteriorly there is inguinal ligament. Below there is Cooper ligament. Medially there is lacunar ligament. And can you see it is making a shape of a trapezoid? Did you see that? And that's why you cannot fire your tacker here. You cannot fire your tacker here. You cannot fire your tacker here. You can fire here. Here what muscle? Rectus abdominis. And here what muscle? Arc of transversus abdominis. Now if hernia is here, which hernia it will be?
Indirect.
All the hernia which is lateral to the inferior epigastric vessel is indirect. And if hernia is here, then? Direct. And if it is here, then? Femoral. And if it is below there? Obturator. So it is very easy in laparoscopy to identify the type of hernia. This is direct hernia, and here this is the indirect hernia. So you can identify in relation to the inguinal ligament. Now what you have to do in TAPP? In TAPP what you have to do, that you have to cut the peritoneum, reflect the peritoneum either side, identify the sac, remove it, and then you put the mesh and reinforce the entire this area. Everything, vas deferens, spermatic vessel, inguinal ligament, Cooper ligament, rectus abdominis, inferior epigastric, extra-iliac artery, extra-iliac vein, nerves, everything should be covered by the mesh. And then fire few tackers for fixation, and after that close the peritoneum. That's all. This is what you have to do. This is a 3D.
We remove the peritoneum over the vessels also.
Yes, over the vessels also.
Then put the mesh.
Put the mesh over the vessel. Peritoneum will be removed. You know, below the peritoneum, posterior to the mesh, only peritoneum has to be there. Rest of the entire structure will be anterior. Like inferior epigastric vessel, vas deferens, spermatic vessel, iliac vessel, triangle of dome, triangle. Anterior, I am saying anterior in relation to the body of the patient. Isn't it? If you will talk about laparoscopy, then everything should be behind the mesh. In front of the mesh, what should be there? Only peritoneum. This is the external iliac artery, this is external iliac vein, and this is inferior epigastric vessel, which is originating. This is the vas deferens, this is spermatic vessel. This is just a sketch. Do you know sometime what we say? That we say that it is just like a Mercedes sign. This is a Mercedes sign. If you see here, okay, and this is just like inguinal ligament. Yeah. So, if hernia is here, then which hernia? This is inferior epigastric vessel, and this is vas deferens, and this is spermatic vessel. And if hernia is here, direct. And if hernia is here, femoral. And this is triangle of doom. This is triangle of pain. And here trapezoid of disaster. So it is very easy to remember. Laparoscopic hernia anatomy is not difficult. Only these 9 important structures you have to remember: median, medial, lateral, and 3 inguinal ligament, Cooper ligament, and lacunar ligament, and then 3 dangerous area: triangle of doom, triangle of pain, trapezoid of disaster. So this is pubic tubercle. This is anterior superior iliac spine. This is inguinal ligament. Here with the median umbilical ligament. This is medial umbilical ligament. This is lateral umbilical ligament. That is inferior epigastric vessel. This is rectus abdominis muscle. Here is the vas deferens. This is a spermatic vessel. Here is the aberrant obturated vessel. And if hernia is here, which hernia? Indirect. And if it is here, then direct. And if it is here, then femoral. And this is triangle of doom. This is trapezoid of disaster. And this is triangle of pain. And this is LFCN, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve of thigh. And this is genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. So it's not difficult. It's very easy. Just keep in mind the 9 important structure. And diagnosis of the type of hernia doesn't make any difference. Even if it is direct hernia, even if it is indirect hernia, surgery is same. But only few tricks are there which I will discuss. This is just to orient you on the left side, because all the picture before slide we have seen was on the right side. So this is left side. Here is what? Pubic tubercle. This is what?
Yes.
Anterior superior iliac spine. And this is? Inguinal ligament. This is?
Median
umbilical ligament. This is? Medial umbilical ligament. Very good. This is? Lateral umbilical ligament. This is deep ring. If hernia is here, which hernia?
Indirect.
What is this? Vas. And this is?
Spermatic
vessel. And this is? External iliac artery and vein, triangle of doom. Yes. And this is triangle of?
Pain.
And this is trapezoid of? Disaster. If hernia is here, then?
Direct.
If it is here, then? And if it is here, then? Abdominal. So, key landmark is inferior epigastric vessel. Any defect lateral to inferior epigastric vessel is indirect, medial to inferior epigastric is direct, and medial to inferior and below the inguinal ligament is femoral. Isn't it? Medial to inferior epigastric vessel. Medial to, this is inferior epigastric. Medial to inferior epigastric and below the inguinal ligament is femoral. Obturator is very rare. Hardly you will see in your life one or two cases. Otherwise, obturator is not commonly found.
Now, regarding the femoral hernia, the same principle.
What is the principle I am talking now? First, let me describe the anatomy. Then, what is the principle behind that I will discuss. So, this is direct, this is indirect, this is femoral. Sometime you have a sliding hernia. Sometime you have a pantaloon hernia, that is a mixture of direct and indirect. Now, there is one more classification that is called a laparoscopic classification of hernia. So, laparoscopically, they have described the hernia into the external inguinal, medial inguinal and internal inguinal. External inguinal is just like indirect hernia. Medial inguinal is like a direct hernia and femoral. And internal inguinal hernia is in between the median and medial umbilical ligament. Now the question is, what was the need of this classification? Already we have classification, old classification is pretty good, femoral, direct, indirect. What is the need? Need is because of principle of hernia. You know, if you will see the old textbook, what they write, they write that the hernia should be, dissection should be started from anterior superior iliac spine and then you go up to the medial umbilical ligament. Actually, it is not good. You should not remember this way. You should remember according to principle. And the principle, what it say, that in cases of laparoscopic hernia repair, your dissection should be in such a way, this is hernia, suppose, at this place, and here, suppose that much defect is there, and this is the inferior epigastric vessel going, this is the vas deferens, and here is the spermatic vessel. So, you should perform the surgery in such a way that 6 cm all around the margin of the defect, your mesh should must project everywhere. Like suppose this is defect and if you put a mesh, then 6 cm this side, 6 cm this side, 6 cm this side, 6 cm this side, 6 cm this side. Mesh should project beyond the healthy margin of the defect. And the center of the mesh should must be in the center of the defect. Then only your surgery is good. Suppose defect is 4 cm, then if 6 cm this side and 6 cm this side, mesh has to project, then what should be the size of mesh? 12 plus?
16.
Yes, 12 plus defect. That is 12 plus 4 is 16 by 16 mesh. The size of the mesh should be 12 plus defect. If defect is 4 cm, mesh should be 16 by 16. Defect is 3 cm, mesh should be 15 by 15. Defect is 1 cm, then you can make 13 by 13 also. Pardon? Yes. If it is multiple defect, then all the defects should be considered as one defect. Like suppose this is indirect and direct. Suppose this is This is 3 cm. There is a 1 cm. And this is 2 cm. Then 3, 2 and 1 is 6. And 6 plus 12, 18 by 18. So breast should must project 6 cm beyond the outer margin. And in multiple defect, all the defects should be considered as one defect, single defect. Do you know why? Because at the end of 1 year, miss has to shrink 40% normally, generally, average. So suppose you are putting that much a small miss, this is a defect, and you are putting a small miss, it will migrate into the defect. And after 6 months, patient come with the recurrence. But if you have used a big mess like that much big mess, then a lot of fibrosis, once it develops also, it will be anchored nicely and there will be no defect. This is one principle. Second principle, that even if you are using a big mess, if your center of the mess is not in the center of the defect, then you are wasting your mess. Like I have a big mess, but I am putting it like this. Then for this side, I have 10 cm and this side, I have 2 cm. So if it will shrink from this side, recurrence will occur. So not only the big mess, the fixation of the mess should be in such a way that center of, that's why they have done laparoscopic classification. Suppose there is a hernia, which hernia is present here? That is in between median and medial umbilical ligament. Then in those situations, your mesh should be placed in a way that mesh should must go opposite to the midline. You got it? What I mean to say? It will cross the median umbilical ligament and you go to the midline. If you have a indirect hernia, then it may not be necessary to cross the midline. Inferomedial end of the mesh should be over the upper ligament, isn't it? If it is femoral hernia, then mesh has to go like that. Suppose this is femoral here. Why mesh has to go like that? Because mesh, a portion of the mesh has to go to the space of radius. That is a space of radius, that is the retropubic space. So the fixation of the mesh will depend upon location of the hernia. So that's why they say external inguinal hernia. So in external inguinal hernia, the mesh should may go as lateral as anterior superior iliac spine. But in cases of direct hernia, it may go to the opposite side. And it may be in the median inguinal hernia. It has to be in the midline and half of the mesh right, half of the mesh left. That's the reason this type of classification has been given. So again, see that if this is the external inguinal hernia, mesh will be like this. If it is medial inguinal hernia, little mesh go to the opposite side, but mesh will be this way. And if it is median, that mesh will be in the anterior abdominal wall, in between both the medial umbilical ligament. So, if you remember this classification or not, but the principle is clear that you should put the mesh in a way. Question sometimes ask that how much I should dissect down. If I am dissecting into triangle of doom, triangle of pain, trapezoid of disaster, then how much I should go this side, how much medial, how much lateral, how much anterior, how much superior. It is simple, 6 cm. All around the healthy margin of defect. So you have to go 6 cm below, 6 cm medial, 6 cm above and 6 cm lateral. That's all. And you have to make a pocket. Why should I make a pocket? To put the mesh. So that mesh should be covered by the peritoneum. And make a pocket. And what is the aim of your making the pocket? Separating the peritoneum from the rest of the structure. Putting the mesh and suturing it. So this is the way how the laparoscopic hernia surgery is performed. It doesn't depend that it is a inguinal, if it is a direct, if it is a indirect, it is the same principle is applied. In old time, a lot of fixation is there. Nowadays, principles are coming, no fixation or very less fixation. It is a very strange. In our last conference of the World Association of Laparoscopic Surgeons, we have a lot of discussion, and if you will see, no fixation of mesh. No fixation of mesh in inguinal hernia. Then a lot of authors are agree that these tackers are bad. Randomized practice, totally extrapatoral hernia surgery, randomized objective observer, even in the TAPP, mesh fixation compared with no fixation. Transabdominal, preperitoneal, laparoscopic inguinal hernia. What I say, you will be surprised. The TAPP inguinal hernia without mesh fixation is safe and feasible. For last 15 years, this company has, all these company people has made us foolish. And this, they always make it like that. Even the gastric band, they rule the world for many years, made trillions of dollars, and ultimately this gastric band was one of the foolish idea which has proved now otherwise. And people, all the band they are removing, isn't it? These tackers, not use tackers. These are the conspiracy by the company people. You can see these articles. A lot of articles are published in the one of our student. He has presented the paper in 5 year study. His name was Sohail Bakar. One of his friend is already there. That was spelling maybe little wrong, but it will be corrected. Sorry, S-H-S-U. Are you sure?
Yeah. No.
So, okay, anyway, it will come. Walls, hernia, and this was a very good presentation. Is it coming?
Yes,
this one, yes. Fourth one. So it is the same, the idea was fixation, no fixation, and his study has been published in Springer Link also, surgical endoscopy also, and in Walsh Journal also. So he has this presented this, that no fixation is good. Do you know why? You will say why? Why you are saying like that? I will tell you. In old time, people were over fixing it. See here, so many tackers. Over fixation, what it does, that suppose this is the defect, and here is the hernia. This is the anatomy, and you have put the mesh. Here is your mesh. This is the mesh. Now these areas you cannot fix. And now you are fixing here, fixing here, fixing here, fixing here, fixing here, fixing here, fixing here. If you will try to, if you have a blanket, and if you will try to, your complete face with the pillow, your foot will be pulled, isn't it? Exactly same way, if you fix on one side, then this side mesh cannot shrink, but inferiorly in this side it is not fixed. So all this side of the mesh will start pulling it up. You got it? And then if this is the defect, slowly this mesh will shrink up and it will come at this level. And then it come at this level and there will be recurrence. But if you will not fix it, only use a big mesh, then if it contract, it contract from all the sides. And then still the center of the mesh will be in the center of the defect. So excessive use of tacker is not good. One or two fixation is good. Do you know why? So that mesh should not migrate. In old time, people were thinking that this is the tacker which is giving the strength and this is the tacker which is repairing the hernia. But actually, this is not the tacker which is repairing the hernia. This is fibrosis which develops through the mesh and which make a layer of the neorectus type of wall in the defect. That gives the strength of the hernia. And use of excessive tacker is bad. So, no fixation, that's why these articles say that no fixation is better or less fixation is better than the over fixation. So nowadays, we don't fix it more. Just you reinforce the entire myopectinal orifice. Even if it is a multiple defect, you put a big mesh and maybe fix couple of them, 1, 2, 3, that's all. Or you apply a suture. One over the Cooper, another over rectus abdominis, third over arc of transversus abdominis. And it is done. Choice of mesh is also a conspiracy by the company people. Do you know they make a lot of mesh starting from 800 rupees up to 80,000 rupees. But for TAPP actually, peritoneum is covering it, so you don't need any expensive mesh. You have the 3D mesh, auto-fixating mesh, proceed mesh, omega-3 fatty acid mesh, Dacron mesh, and auto-fixating mesh. But you don't need it. For laparoscopy, pure polypropylene mesh is best. Especially for TAPP, because it will be covered by peritoneum. Now, you have to identify the anatomy. This is the real picture here. This is the, what is this? This is bladder. What is this? This is? No. This is the pubic tubercle. And here will be the Cooper ligament. What is this? Medial umbilical ligament. Median will be here, isn't it? This is medial umbilical. What is this? Lateral umbilical ligament. That is inferior epigastric vessel. What is this? Deep ring. This is vas. This is spermatic vessel. This is triangle of doom. This is triangle of pain. So this is, and is there any hernia in this patient? No. There is no hernia. This is a normal inguinal anatomy, laparoscopic view. Normal inguinal anatomy, laparoscopic view. Now we will see some abnormal. I am giving you some idea. And I am giving you, suppose this is bladder. Then what is this?
Medial.
Medial of which side?
Left side.
And what is this?
Inferior.
Inferior epigastric vessel. Very good. And here should be the deep ring. Isn't it?
Yes.
Is there any hernia?
No.
No. Remember, only seeing the fat doesn't tell you hernia in laparoscopy. And this is the vas, this is a spermatic vessel. Now, this side, do you see anything? Here is the hernia. In laparoscopy, hernia you cannot hide. It will pop up. It will look like a black hole. And the gas immediately enters CO2 into the hernia and scrotum will swell up. Or if it is direct hernia, you will see the bulge there. You cannot hide the hernia in laparoscopy because it is a defect. And in that defect, directly the gas enters, CO2 enters. So this is, and what is this? Medial umbilical ligament. What is this? Vas. What is this?
Spermatic.
What is this? Inferior epigastric vessel. And this is which hernia? Indirect hernia. Indirect hernia. How you will know what is the diameter of hernia? You go with the open jaw of Maryland and catch it like that, and then 2 and 2, 4. Here you will open, one jaw will go up to here and then one jaw here, 4 cm, 3 cm. The defect size can be measured easily. It is not necessary to measure millimeter by millimeter. Even if it is 3 cm and 4 cm, it hardly matters. It is not that you have to make a tape there and then you measure and see the hernia. And here, what is this? Bladder. What is this? Pubic symphysis. What is this? Medial of left side. This is lateral of left side. What is this? Vas. And what is this? Spermatic. And what is this? Triangle of doom. Here is triangle of pain. And there will be trapezoid of disaster. So this is how you will identify the hernia. And it can be easily seen. It is even people who have no experience of open hernia surgery also, they can do laparoscopic hernia surgery with these anatomies. Now, this is again the another case. In this patient, you can see here that this is, I will give you the idea, this is the bladder here. This is the bladder. Then, what is this hernia?
Direct.
Yes, direct hernia. Do you know, direct hernia has victory sign. It has two soldiers, one this, and it gives you the victory sign. Medial to the direct hernia will be medial umbilical ligament, and lateral to the direct hernia will be lateral umbilical ligament. Whereas, in indirect hernia, you have only medial soldier. Lateral, there is a plain abdominal wall, nothing is there. Only medial side you have. But in direct hernia, it has two soldiers. One is medial, other is lateral. And it is in between lateral and medial. So this is inferior epigastric vessel, that is lateral umbilical ligament, and this is medial umbilical ligament, and this is a small direct hernia. This is indirect hernia, where laterally nothing present, medially there is a medial umbilical ligament, and this is the vas, this is the spermatic, which is going inside, and this is inferior epigastric vessel, and this is indirect hernia on the right side. Sometimes you have femoral hernia. Here if you see, this is bladder, this is Cooper ligament, here is the inguinal ligament, and this is inferior epigastric vessel, this is vas, this is spermatic vessel, this is iliac vessel, triangle of doom, and this is the femoral hernia, which is below the inguinal ligament. This is the level of inguinal. This is obturator hernia, which is too deep, and in the obturator foramen it is going. Sometime in this patient, left side direct hernia, and in the same patient, you have the right-sided indirect hernia. That may be possible. This is irreducible hernia, as you told. That in irreducible hernia, if you will try to pull it, you cannot pull it. Sometimes if you have a harmonic, what you can do, silicon jaw of the harmonic, you can push into the ring, and with the vibrating jaw, you can cut the ring at the level of 2 o'clock position. 2 o'clock position. And then it can be reduced, but risky. Risky. We never know that we can perforate it also. And remember, once you have perforated the bowel, at least hernia surgery you cannot do. You can repair the bowel and come out, because you cannot put a mess once the bowel is punctured. It will create a severe infection, isn't it? So that's why it is better not to select this type of irreducible. Sometimes it is incarcerated with the omentum. In those situations, you can try to remove the omentum by the harmonic or bipolar, and then with a stone holding forceps, the remaining bunch of the omentum from the deep ring you can strip out.
Can you push from outside?
Yes, of course. Whenever content is not coming, your assistant should must excuse the scrotum and the skin there to reduce it. You have to do that. And facilitate it by external as well as internal traction, and you should try to reduce it. But most of the time, you know, as soon as pneumoperitoneum is made and patient is relaxing, automatically it reduces. If you have to reduce it, that means it has irreducible hernia. Because in laparoscopy, once abdomen distended, then the defect stretches itself. And gas enters, and gas itself will reduce because abdomen is distended. Gravity play a role. But if you have to do it to reduce it, that means it was a irreducible hernia. It may not be strangulated, but it was a irreducible hernia. Because under GA and under pneumoperitoneum it is not reducing. That means many a time patient, for many days it was not reducing. Only few time it was reducing. So that should be classified as
irreducible.
Actually, you know, if you have encountered after putting the telescope inside that it is an irreducible hernia, then you should try. But clinically, during the examination of the patient, if you encounter it is an irreducible hernia, then you don't select that patient for laparoscopy, better. But suppose if already we have wrongly selected that patient and already entered into the abdomen, then it is no point now regretting, isn't it? So you should cut the ring and try to reduce it. But if already irreducible, then better to do open. Because in open, what you are doing with the seizures, you are cutting the ring away, and then with the finger, finger is the best instrument to reduce. With the grasper, can you think how much difficult it is to pull the intestine? And if you pull it, it lacerates, what will happen? So that's why irreducible hernia is a contraindication. So this way you will identify and you will diagnose the hernia first. After diagnosing, you will start the your surgery. Patient position should be same way, patient head down and side of hernia up. If patient has right side hernia, head down, right up. Left side hernia, head down, left up. And surgeon should go towards the opposite shoulder. If you are doing right side hernia, surgeon will stand near the left shoulder. If you are doing left side hernia, surgeon will stand near the right shoulder. And then this is the position. Anesthetist must be moved away. Anesthetist should not be given a lot of value in laparoscopy, because generally, if they consider, if they apply the filter, they apply the complete separating cover, then it is very difficult for surgeon, mobility is compromised. So after intubation, anesthetist should be, you should request to go little away, and then you will perform the surgery in this technique. So it is a coaxial alignment which you have to make, and port position is according to baseball diamond concept. So that half of the instrument should be in, half of the instrument should be out, telescope should be in the center, and manipulation angle should be 60 degree. So your port should be 18 centimeter away from the target of dissection. And what is the target in the inguinal hernia? The defect, deep ring. If it is indirect hernia, then it is deep ring, because indirect hernia is an enlargement of deep ring. So if it is the right sided, your port is like that, and you will stand near the left shoulder. If it is left sided, your port will be according to this arc, which you will make with the snuff box of your hand, and you will stand near the opposite shoulder. If it is a bilateral hernia surgery, then you can put all the three port at the same line, and then you can perform the procedure. So you will stand near the opposite shoulder. The hand of your camera person should come in between arm and the body, and he should hold the telescope by the left hand, and in 30 degree telescope, light cable ideally should be kept down. So if you see, this is the camera person, and his hand is coming in between the arm and the body of the surgeon, and the light cable is kept down so that you can see up here. This is the position, and this is where you will hold the telescope and you will do the procedure. And first step is opening of the preperitoneal space. So what you have to do is that, suppose you have already identified the hernia, and suppose this was the hernia here, this is the hernia, suppose this is the hernia, then what you do, you should calculate the outer margin of the defect, and from here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 centimeter lateral to the outer margin of the defect at 2 o'clock position on the right side and 10 o'clock position on the left side, you will start incising the peritoneum. Why 6 centimeter already? Because I want my mesh to go 6 centimeter. And why 2 o'clock position? Because it is safe. If I will go at 3 o'clock position, I can get the nerves, isn't it? If I will go this area, I am not comfortable, here is inferior epigastric. So this is 12 o'clock position, this is 1 o'clock position, and this is 2 o'clock position. So you start at 2 o'clock position, and then here will be your medial umbilical ligament. This is the medial umbilical ligament. So you start at this point, that you start at 2 o'clock position, and then cut up to here. This is shortcut. But medial to the medial umbilical ligament, you should not cut. Why? There is bladder. There is bladder. You know, medial to the medial umbilical ligament, if you will cut, there is a bladder in between. Isn't it? So, medial to the medial umbilical ligament, you should never cut. But your window should be continued even to the opposite side also. So, how to do? You make a pocket. You make a pocket like that. This is a pocket you have to make. So, what to do? Suppose this is a medial umbilical ligament. You just deviate it like that, and then enter into the pocket. So, what is the advantage? That without cutting the bladder, without separating, you can enter into the correct point. And this is how you have to go sometime to the opposite side also. But medial to the medial umbilical ligament, sharp dissection with the seizure should not be done. You will make a prepatinal pocket, but without cutting it. Means you will dig it. You will reflect it down and you make. Do you know in this area, separating the peritoneum, blunt dissection. In this area, separating the peritoneum is very easy. Why? Bladder has a repeated distension, contraction, distension, contraction. So this area, peritoneum is lax. And moreover, we know that below the arcuate line, there is no posterior rectus. So peritoneum is just lying over the muscle directly. So it doesn't have very strong fibrous trabeculis in this area. Bluntly, if you will put a grasper and do 2-3 times, peritoneum will automatically come down. And it can show you the, and what you will see here, you will see the Cooper ligament, isn't it? This will be Cooper. And Cooper goes like that, and here will be the lacunar. Okay? So this way you have to go up to this area. So this is how you perform it, if it is on the right side. If it is on the left side, it is just the this. This is now become flipping of the left side. In left side, what you will do? Your dissection start 10 o'clock position. That is there, of course, so that you have to keep on pulling the peritoneum. And if you stress the peritoneum, automatically inferior epigastric vessel will remain with the anterior abdominal wall. It doesn't come. So, of course, you are absolutely correct. At that point where you are crossing the inferior epigastric vessel, you have to be little careful. Suppose accidentally inferior epigastric vessel is cut also, then you can apply clips or you can apply bipolar, you can coagulate it. Because it is not going to give you mortality. It can be managed. It can be cooked and it doesn't have any harm. You cannot cook or you cannot suture the iliac vessel, isn't it? But inferior epigastric vessel can be easily done. So this is how you will start your dissection. So this is, now this is direct hernia and you press by the peritoneum, then go with one grasper, hold the inferior edge of the peritoneum and pull it down. Here you hold it and pull it down. And after that, go with the seizures, put one jaw of the seizures inside the peritoneum, another jaw out and keep on cutting. And slowly you cut it and go, this is the vast difference, this is a spermatic vessel, hernia is here, this is a direct hernia. So it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It was started at 6 o'clock position. At 2 o'clock position, and then this is the hernia. Can you see the hernia? This is hernia. This is, and then you will keep on. Here is the inferior epigastric vessel. And stretching the peritoneum is very important because once you stretch it, gas itself enters into the peritoneum and that will dissect for you. And you can make a peripatinal space and you can come up to the medial umbilical ligament. And you will, this is inferior epigastric vessel. So that much you have to do sharp dissection. Why? So that you can suture it later. And after that, you will start and you will disaggregate. Now, there is one thing important, that you should always dissect the sac last. This is one of the big mistakes that people they do in hernia surgery, that from the beginning they start catching the defect. Don't do that. You should be patient. Remove the sac at the end. First you dissect triangle of pain, then you dissect trapezoid of disaster, and then you go to the triangle of doom. If you will, from the beginning you will go to the triangle of doom, you will not get the margin of your dissection. And then you will do the mistake. So you should first do the lateral and medial dissection, and then you remove the sac. What is sac? Sac is peritoneum. And you will keep on taking step 1, step 2, step 3, it is out. But before going to these steps, you should dissect the lateral and medial dissection. That is important. So how to do? Hold the peritoneum and then you push the other structure away. And this way slowly you will separate the vast difference or spermatic vessel away. This is important, that stressing the peritoneum will keep you nearer to the peritoneum. So this is, if you see, this is vast difference and this is spermatic vessel. This is triangle of doom. This is external iliac vein. This is external iliac artery. So this is triangle of doom. You should not, vein is medial, artery is lateral. If you see, you can see the pulsation of the artery. And what is this? Medial umbilical ligament. You will never cut medial umbilical ligament. Rather, you will enter into this fold. And this is external iliac artery. And this is external iliac vein. This is vast difference. And you will see the pulsation of the artery. This is pulsation of the artery. This is spermatic vessel. This is external iliac vein, blue color. And this is external iliac artery. You can see the pulsation. This is pulsating. And this is the artery. And our purpose is to remain as nearer as possible to the peritoneum. We don't have to go in deep. We just release the peritoneum and that's all, surgery is over. And then you will put the mesh and you close it. So at the end you will see these type of vision, where vast difference, spermatic vessel, trapezoid of disaster, triangle of doom, triangle of pain, inferior gastric vessel, everything will be clear. And if the hernia is here, muscle defect will start visible. But you don't have to do anything for the muscle. Just this is inferior epigastric vessel, this is vast difference, this is a spermatic vessel, and this is a direct hernia. And then you will cut the mesh. Sometimes the sac doesn't come out. If the sac is so irreducible that it cannot be separated, especially in the prime complete inguinoscrotal hernia, congenital variety, which has developed in the adult, now patient come after 20 years of the surgery, you cannot separate the peritoneum, then you take an endo loop and you can tie the knot. And you can leave the remaining sac into the scrotum. And after that you cut the mesh, put the mesh, fix the mesh with couple of fixation by the tacker, and then close the peritoneum by two techniques. One is called as double brass technique. In double brass technique, what you will do, just like a coat, you will put it like that, one brass over the another, and then you fire the tacker, double brass coat. Or you can use suturing. In suturing, you don't need to do double brassing. And you can suture. So this is double brushing of the tacker and this is suturing. Now whenever you are double brushing, always the inferior fold of the peritoneum should come on the anterior fold. Because if you will bring, because below is more mobile. Second, below has more peritoneum. Why?
Stretch.
The sac which you have taken, that has given you extra peritoneum, isn't it? The sac which you have pulled out, it gives you extra peritoneum. And then upper one, if you will bring it low, what will happen? It will tear also. And another, if you will fire, you can damage the iliac vessel, isn't it? But lower one, if you will go above, you are firing only over the anterior abdominal wall. You are firing over the rectus abdominis and arc of transversus abdominis. But better is to use dandy jamming knot, continuous suturing, and abide in termination. and you close the peritoneum, and then the surgery is over. Now I will show you from the beginning one surgery how to do. So this is the pre-peritoneal incision. It started at 2 o'clock position, and then slowly you will dissect the triangle of pain. So left hand is holding the peritoneum and right hand is separating by the sutures. All the pre-peritoneal fibrous trabeculae will be broken and a space will be created. Our aim is to remain as near as possible to the peritoneum. In this patient, the defect is here. You will see later. The defect is here, but then also it is not started at the defect. Just you cut inside the peritoneum sharp. Can you see the defect now? Here. This is the hernia. Here is the triangle of doom. This is direct hernia. But it doesn't matter. I should not directly go and start dissecting the hernia. It will never work. You will be unnecessarily struggling. Sometime we think that, oh, hernia is there, why should I go there that much? If I go that much, I don't know what will happen, and moreover, my time is increased. But you will be in trouble. So do the hernia sac dissection at the end, not in the beginning. So this is the triangle of pain dissection, that is lateral dissection. And how you will know that you have completed the lateral dissection? You will get which vessel? Spermatic vessel. Why? Medial boundary of triangle of pain is? Spermatic vessel. So this is slowly, and do you know here the sutures is used. But suture is working as what? Blunt dissector. Sutures is not cutting often. The back of the suture is acting as a blunt spatula, and the closed jaw is separating it. There should not be any buttonhole also. If the buttonhole is there, you have to repair it. So slowly you can separate it like that. An entire peritoneum can be separated from triangle of pain area, that is the lateral dissection is done.
If there is a defect in the peritoneum,
if it is a very small defect, if there is a very small defect, it doesn't matter. Do you know why? Once you remove the gas, and abdomen is relaxed, peritoneum close itself. But if it is a big defect, you may have to take a bite to suture it. Otherwise, that portion of the mesh will be exposed to the bowel, and theoretically there is a chance of adhesion, but practically nothing happens.
Can you use composite mesh in that situation?
No, composite mesh will make your expense of the mesh multiple time more. So if you want, why not, you can use it, of course, but it is better to just take a bite rather than using that much, because composite mesh means 20,000 extra. If you use polyurethane mesh, 28,000.
Yeah,
20,000 is a handsome amount of money, isn't it?
If you are using composite and no need dissection, you can do IPO.
Yes, that is also true. So no, so now this is the spermatic vessel here, and then you can do, and it is separated here. After that, this is the spermatic vessel. Can you see that? Now go for, what is this? This is defect, sac. But sac is not done. Lateral dissection is done. Now what is this? Medial umbilical ligament. You will never cut it, but you will go into the tunnel. You will go into the pocket, and this is the sac, and now this is a medial dissection. And slowly, slowly you can separate it. And you will go up to the lighthouse, and how you will recognize, it will start reflecting the light, and here you have to go without cutting the peritoneum in the tunnel. Why? Because you need to make a pocket so that your mesh should go up to here, and this is Cooper ligament here, which is visible, and that is done. If below, if you will enter in further medially, if you will enter, you will enter into the space of Regius, that is the retropubic space. And that is, now you go to the sac. So once the lateral dissection is done, then medial dissection is done, and now you go to the sac. In the sac, you hold as near as possible to the peritoneum. And remember, again, one key point is there, that the beginners, they start dissecting the transversalis fascia. And that is called as pseudo sac. And if you start dissecting the transversalis fascia, it will never come. And for hours you are struggling, you will get a lot of bleeding, a lot of hematoma, a lot of seroma, and unnecessarily your patient will have the morbidity. So This is the peritoneum here, and this is the real sac. This is the true sac that is belongs to the peritoneum. And see here, this is pseudo sac. Can you see that? And accidentally, if you are over enthusiastic and you catch it too near to the ring, you will catch the pseudo sac. And pseudo sac transversalis fascia cannot be removed by blunt dissection. And sometimes pulling so much that even the testis come near the deep ring. If it happens, you have to ask your assistant from outside to hold the testis back into the scrotum. But most of the time it happens because of two reasons. One reason, you are holding the wrong plane. Another reason, the patient has a complete inguinal scrotal hernia. Isn't it? In those situations, it is very difficult to separate the peritoneum from transversalis fascia. So this is transversalis fascia here, and this is peritoneum. Slowly, slowly you will separate it. Here, this is pseudo sac. Can you see clearly?
Yeah.
This is pseudo sac, and this is true sac. True sac is peritoneum. Pseudo sac is transversalis fascia.
That's usually injured here, isn't it?
Yes. So you hold it, and sorry. So hold it and start dissecting it. So this is how you have to perform the dissection of the pseudo sac from the real sac, and slowly, slowly blunt dissection, blunt dissection. Peritoneum will be anterior to the vas deferens and supraventricular vessel, so you can easily separate it, and it should be completely separated. Ideally, this is pseudo sac, which you will separate from the true sac, and this is the most important part of the laparoscopic hernia surgery. Because if you will not separate it, then TAPP will have more recurrence. In IPOM, you don't have to do this. You can just cover this sac also without removing the sac. But in TAPP and TEP, it is important.
So
otherwise,
cut that second ligament.
And this is now muscle defect. Now the telescope is in the muscle defect. Yes, if it is not separating, your question is, can I ligate? You can like it, but when you tie a knot, you cut distal to the knot so that the portion which has been left into the scrotum should not be closed. Otherwise, it will form the hydrocele. Isn't it? So, the portion which is towards the abdomen, the knot should come towards your side and then cut distal to that.
Another knot?
No, that area will be one knot only. Suppose this is the sac going inside, then you apply the knot and cut distal to the knot. So that area which is left behind into the scrotum, the mouth of that should not be closed. It should open. So that, and this side is cut. Why? Otherwise a buttonhole is formed. The knot should be towards the your side. And then this is 6 cm all around. This is Cooper ligament, this is pubic symphysis bone. This is all around 6 cm, you will nicely open the peritoneum. Here is the vas deferens, this is spermatic vessel, this is triangle of doom, this is triangle of pain, this is trapezoid of disaster, and you must go every side 4 to 6 cm. Generally, I recommend you 6 cm, some books say they up to 4 cm also, you can make a pocket. Again, this is another case, just to have a demonstration, video demonstration, that here also this is the medial umbilical ligament. This is a very small hernia, a small pantaloon hernia. This is inferior epigastric vessel, and here direct and indirect both are there, but very small, like bubonicil type of hernia. And this is the Foley's catheter in the bladder. This is the medial umbilical ligament, this is the vas deferens, this is a spermatic vessel, here is the external iliac artery and vein, this is appendix, this is triangle of pain, this is triangle of doom, this is trapezoid of disaster, this is bladder, so this is vas, and this is a spermatic vessel or gonadal vessel, and then this is the anatomy. So first you visualize the anatomy, all the 9 important landmarks. You keep in the mind, in the memory, and then start
6 cm lateral to the outer margin of the defect and press by the finger anterior abdominal wall, and then peritoneal incision started giving. You may use the current also a little bit if you want, but peritoneum hardly bleeds, it's only ooze a little bit, and then you can start your incision from that point. During giving that incision, care should be taken. The transversalis fascia should not be taken. You should try to take only the peritoneum. If you will take a transversalis fascia, it cannot be stretched further. And then start going from the top of the defect. And it is the lateral dissection is going on. From the top of the defect, we should never cross through the defect. We should go from the top of the defect. And here it is reaching up to the medial umbilical ligament.
So the incision should be circular?
Yes. It should be circular. It depends upon the location of hernia. If it is direct, then directly you can go also. If it is indirect, then it may have to cross. Because suppose this is the defect. Suppose this is defect. You cannot cross the defect. Because how can you cross the defect? Because in the defect there is a sac. Isn't it? So if you encircle the defect from the top, then you will get something to catch. The edge you will get to catch. And then you will pull and push, pull and push, pull and push, and like that you can defect it. So that's why, because you will get an edge to hold. And then that's why you should encircle on the top of the defect, and you will reach up to the medial umbilical ligament. And this is your last boundary, that is medial umbilical ligament. Now sharp dissection has no role, blunt dissection started.
If the defect is big, should we approximate the edges or not?
Some people they do that, but there is no any advantage. Use big mesh if it is big defect. And now this is the triangle of pain, that is the lateral dissection started.
Do we need to reduce the pressure while fixing the mesh or
not? If you have a good sac coming out, then you will not need to reduce the pressure, because good sac is reduced, give you a lot of extra peritoneum, so that there will no any tension over the edges of the peritoneum during suturing. But if you have a tight abdomen, very less sac came and very flimsy and peritoneum, then reduce the pressure up to 8 mm of mercury at the time of suturing or fixation of the peritoneum, not at the time of fixation of the mesh. Fixation of peritoneum. This is triangle of pain. Can you see that? Here, this is the incision, this is the incision, and then you start your lateral dissection on the triangle of pain area, and then you go to the trapezoid of disaster, then you go to the
lower limit of dissection.
6 cm below.
No, dissection how can
6 cm below the lower margin. You got it? 6 cm below the lower margin means iliac vessel should be exposed.
So while doing on the left side.
This is also 6 cm. Lateral is also 6 cm. Below is also 6 cm. Above is also 6 cm. Medial is also 6 cm. Yes.
So while doing on the left side, this should be carried out by a bone and hand.
Actually, ideally, you should keep the scissors in the left hand. But if you want to use scissors in the right hand, then you can dissect medial to lateral. You can start your dissection from the medial umbilical ligament. You got it? And then you go to the anterior superior iliac spine. Because keeping in the scissor in the right hand, you can go this way. Because you cannot go that way. Medial to lateral is no problem, but ideally it is better to do lateral to medial. Do you know why? Because if you have a left-sided hernia and you keep the scissor in the right hand, your tip of the scissor will be at right angle to the inferior epigastric vessel. And you have to be very careful to protect it. But if you go to the left hand, it will be parallel to the peritoneum. So you will be easily managed. But suppose your left hand is not working at all, then some people they use in the right hand, but they go medial to lateral for left side. For right side, right-handed people will go lateral to medial. So this way, you can dissect here. Lateral dissection is almost complete, and then you will go. This is the below is the this is the this is the this is inferior epigastric vessel, here with the spermatic vessel, this is inferior epigastric vessel, and this is the one defect and this is second defect. Two defects are there here in this case, and both the defect will be considered as a one single defect. And now this is medial dissection, and medial dissection is easy. Do you know why? Peritoneum of this area has a lot of fibrous trabeculitis, areolar tissue and loose space there in the medial aspect. And this is the Cooper ligament now. Can you see the lighthouse? This is lighthouse. This lighthouse, and here is the inferior epigastric vessel, this one. So this lighthouse will tell you that I am here and you are correct, your alignment is good, and then you dissect. And now you go to the sac area. This is a very small babinocele type of hernia. So sac is so easily coming out, and you can separate in this sac area. So initially in your career, you should start selecting the direct hernia, because direct hernia is easy. Because in direct hernia, there is nothing adhered with the sac. After that, slowly you should start going to the indirect hernia. And then you can start taking the big hernia, recurrent hernia, multiple hernia. But slowly you should start. So here this is the sac now. And this was the hernia in this point. So now this peritoneum also has to be separated. Vast difference in spermatic vessel, this will be triangle of doom also has to be separated. So sometimes the patient has used truss, or if it is already once open surgery has been performed, then you may encounter some of the incarceration of the and fat there in those area. This is slowly separated. So making the pre-peritoneal space is one of the important tasks in the laparoscopic hernia surgery. And in that, your main aim is to just prevent the injury of the dangerous area, triangle of doom, triangle of pain, trapezoid of disaster, and remain as nearer as possible to the peritoneum. We should never go much deeper into the, and then this is again separating the peritoneum. This is what? A spermatic vessel, isn't it? And this is what? Vast difference. And defect is above. So your question was how much below I should go. So see how much below you are going. It is 6 centimeter or minimum 4. 4 to 6 whatever means 2 jaw of open maryland should cover all around the healthy margin of the defect. 2 open jaw of the maryland should calculate all around the healthy margin of the defect. And here it is the bladder, and this is the iliac vessel pulsation. Can you see that? This is the transmitted pulsation of the iliac vessel that is moving the vast difference, because iliac vessels are going like that, and this is the peritoneum defect is done. So now once you have achieved it and you have done a good pocket, you know, if you not make a good pocket, you have to be ready for recurrence, because there is a fair chance of recurrence if your pocket is insufficient. So good pocket has to be made. And now you put the mesh. This is a pure polypropylene mesh, and you fix it. Inferomedial end of the mesh is fixed over the Cooper ligament and then all around. In this patient, there is a fibrin glue which is used to fix. If you will use fibrin glue or if you use tacker, cost is almost same. Fibrin glue has better outcome, because shrinking it get dissolved after 2 weeks. By the time fibrosis has already anchored the mesh, and that's why recurrence chances are less. It is easy to apply, and it doesn't have any fear of nerve entrapment or the pain. So even in the tap and tip, not IPOM only, even in the tap and tip, people have started using the fibrin glue. So take care that mesh should be nicely spread, and that's why you have struggled right now that much to make this pocket. Purpose was just to make this pocket and spread it all around so that center of the mesh should be in the center of the defect. Sometimes if it is not spreading in at one go, you fix at one place and then spread to the other place. So now it is spread all over, and inferomedial end of the mesh should rest over the Cooper ligament, which we can see inferomedial end of the mesh should be rest over the Cooper ligament. This is Cooper ligament and this is inferomedial end of the mesh. That is one of the corner, inferomedial corner. Here is a triangle of doom, triangle of pain, trapezoid of disaster. Some more pocket is increased so that when you cover the mesh, mesh should not be folded. Sometime if you don't have sufficient pocket, once you approximate the peritoneum, mesh will fold. And even using a big mesh doesn't have any advantage. And this is a fibrin glue. It looks very transparent. It looks just like a liquid, but it is very good. It gets fixed and it anchors the mesh in the position. And now this is a reabsorbable tackers, so that this is double brass technique. The peritoneum below is pulled up to the anterior abdominal wall, and it will be countered by the anterior abdominal wall finger from above. You should must be careful that inferior epigastric vessels should not be tacked, and then you will fire it. At this time, as you have already told, that pressure of the pneumoperitoneum can be decreased to 8 mm of mercury if it is required. If it is required, so that it can, if it is a stretched peritoneum, sometime cannot approximate and it can tear. So this is done, and now entire mesh is covered by the peritoneum, and that's all, surgery is over. If you are seeing a small, this type of a small hole, it doesn't matter, because as soon as the abdomen gas is removed, automatically it will stuck there. So if you are seeing, you can just fire with the medial umbilical ligament, and this way you can perform. And this is the fixation by the protac and tacker. Different implants are there, like anchor, a stapler, protac, absorbable implant, fibrin glue, and the best is suturing knotting. If you want suturing knotting, it will be much convenient. So this way, it is fired.
If I will do
if you want to do, no, in pediatric laparoscopic hernia repair, you have to just close the peritoneum. I will show you after this how to do pediatric hernia repair.
Fixing mesh inside, you can straight away peritoneum.
You can do that. You can do that, but you should have a big mesh. If you are fixing at least on the Cooper, what is the advantage? It will not move. It will not migrate. So at least one fixation on the Cooper ligament is a good idea. That doesn't allow the mesh to move. And then it is fixation by the tacker. Now,
the glue, the same cost of tacker.
Yes.
Why glue. Not always use glue for
safety? Yes, you should, but glue has a lot of problems. Problem is technical problem, not the problem of the glue. Technical problem is it needs a special sprayer. It needs a special thermal preparation. And if you will do little wrong fixation, it doesn't work. You know, in your course it is there how to make the fibrin glue. There is one special vibrator over which you have to keep all the four bottles, small bottles. And it has a thermal base which heat the bottle at appropriate temperature. Then you have to mix it, and after mixing there is a small CO2 cylinder and there is a sprayer. So it is a little complicated, and moreover, if you will not mix in properly, then your this cost of 15,000 is gone. It will just work as a simple liquid, no power.
Plus you need the tackers for the closure of the peritoneum.
No, that you can do suturing. It is not necessary. So, it is not necessary. So, I will just demonstrate you a little bit, because you have asked that how to do the when in inguinal hernia in the pediatric case. So, it is very easy, and it is just a mesh you have to take, and no mesh has to be taken, just a suture. This is inferior epigastric vessel. This is vas spermatic vessel. Here you can see this is medial umbilical ligament, this is medial umbilical ligament, this is inferior epigastric vessel, this is the defect. vast difference in aortic vessel, and you will just take a persisting suture all around. But taking care that anything preperitoneal should not be taken. Anything preperitoneal should not be taken. And only pay to anything like vast differences, aortic vessels should not be taken. And take a persisting and tie a knot. That's all. Hernia is over. You don't have to cut the sac. You don't have to do herniotomy. You don't have to put any mesh. Do you know why? Because it was already in the process of closure. Because cell intelligence of this area, God has given already the cell intelligence of this tissue to obliterate. But due to any reason, this process was delayed. And due to that now, due to the viscous pressure, it is not closing. So once you close the defect, then automatically the remaining sac which is inside, it will obliterate. Only thing is that it should not be together with the congenital hydrocele of the sac. Hydrocele of the cord, if it is there, then laparoscopy is not a good procedure. You should do better open. But if it is a pure inguinal hernia in the congenital defect, then laparoscopy is good, and just a persisting suture over the peritoneum is required, and you can close the defect. Sometime when we go for any other surgery in female or in the male, like you go for appendicectomy, and you see that a small hernia is developing in that patient, then we do, even in the adult, we take a persisting and we tie the knot. Because we have not taken the consent from the patient for the hernia, and we have not arranged the mesh, and already you are doing appendicectomy. But if you want the patient to little help, you may apply the peritoneum closer there. But in pediatric, always it is done.
Sometimes we can put mesh plug.
Plug and mesh and plug was one of the technique which was advocated in 1990s. And that is a cone, and with the mesh which you can plug into the canal. But it has been observed later that it was creating little more erosion or incarceration. So that technique is not very practical nowadays in laparoscopy. Not only that, in older time people were cutting the mesh also. And suppose this is a vast difference, they were putting the mesh this way. You got my idea, like that. So that, what was the idea? That they were thinking that this mesh is not going to press the vase. It will be cut that way. So, but later it was found that the cut edge of the sharp margins were doing more erosion to the vase. So right now you should not split the mesh. You should cover the entire myopectineal orifice with the mesh. Without doing the plug, that will do the erosion without doing those things, and without splitting the mesh also.
Yes.
So now this is a persisting suture apply, and you can nicely tight it, and only 2-3 times. So suturing, of course, in a small baby you have a very less space, but it is peritoneum, so it is good. And then second and third knot can be taken. So
what suture you are using?
This is proline. This is proline, because at least one suture should be a suture which should not be absorbed. Mesh you cannot use, so at least, and here it is closed. This way you can perform the pediatric hernia surgery, and it has a good outcome. It has a good outcome. Although open is also hardly takes 10 minutes time in the pediatric cases, because you can just give a small incision and you can separate it. Now a complication. This is a cartoon made by a open surgeon against the laparoscopic surgeon. Stabbing the abdominal wall, pumping the gas in the abdomen. Nurse is praying to God, and animals are waiting for patient to die who will eat them. So people were a lot of against the laparoscopic hernia repair, that this is a worse procedure, why to do, this is not good. But now it is, it has been accepted. In the beginner's hand, sometime recurrence is 100%. So first few cases, you should always be ready that after 6 months, patient is going to come back. So you should give a lot of advice to the patient, do this, do that, don't lift this, don't lift that. Do you know why? Because once you have started going, as you have asked how much below I have to go, once you start going over the triangle of doom, triangle of pain, then your palpitation started. Because seeing the iliac vessel pulsating make you fear. Then you put the vest anyhow, cover it and run away from surgery. Now what happens? That slowly it shrinks and then defect is exposed. After 6 months, mesh is displaced up because center of the vest was not in the center of the defect. So by the time margin was covering, it is okay, but once it is shrink, recurrence happens. Then excessive use of staplers or tackers in the older time, big pain. I have a couple of email in through our hospital website that I can pay any amount of money. Please remove all my tackers which is used by my surgeon. And since then, I have a metallic taste in my mouth. I don't know why this comes as a metallic. Patient is psychologically ill. And I have pain also in both the thigh, skin, lateral aspect. And not only that, I cannot eat also because I get metallic taste of this titanium in my mouth. So psychologically, patient is ill. Now it's virtually impossible by, I don't know any surgery which can remove all these tackers. Isn't it? It is so small, so hidden in the muscle and the fibrous tissue that even a good C-arm cannot show you, and extensive surgery is required to remove it. So that's why overuse of the tacker is bad. Then other complication is iliac vessel injury. There may be mortality. If it is inferior epigastric, iliopubic vein or spermatic vessel, then seroma develops. Hematoma develops. Best way of not letting the seroma develop is take a sponge and give a very tight scrotal support and just like a coconut bandage which we use for hydrocele. Isn't it? So you don't leave any sac space, dead space for the sac to or seroma to develop. If you do a lot of dissection, a lot of bleeding, then seroma chances are more. If seroma develops, you should not be in hurry to aspirate it. Just do conservatively, it gets absorbed. If you will try to aspirate it, it may get infected. And once it gets infected, and if the mesh is getting infected, now it's a big problem. Without removing the mesh, it will not cure. And removal is also defective with the laparoscopy. You have to do by open. So this is the vascular injury. Now nerve injury. Lateral femoral cutaneous nerve of thigh, this injures 2% in the cases. And it has two outcomes. One outcome is immediate, other outcome is delayed. Suppose you did surgery in the morning and afternoon you go to round. And you go to the round and you saw the patient, how are you? Patient say that everything is fine, but I don't know why here I have a lot of burn and abrasion and it's scratching, it's very painful. That means patient fate is clear. You have cut the nerve permanently and there is no cure. Only thing what can be done later, that you can give the cryotherapy to destroy the sensory branch also. But life long numbness will be there. This is first type of outcome, that is immediate outcome. Immediate outcome means pain starts within 24 hours of the surgery. Now, another outcome is delayed outcome, where the patient is discharged fine, patient come after 4-5 days, and then she complain or he complain that I have some sensation and paresthesia here. Now, that is not a significant because it is due to the local inflammation, edema, and the pressure of the nerve over the mesh. So, you can give percutaneous steroid. Or as I told you, give Magitol or Tegretol 200 mg thrice daily, prescribe it for 6 weeks. Within 4 to 6 weeks, patient will be okay. Will be no problem. So this is the nerve LFCN. Other is GFN. GFN is 1% incidence of injury is there. And with the time, it invariably subsides. That gives paresthesia and hyperesthesia over the skin of the scrotum, but invariably it subsides. Other complication is migration of the mesh. There was 6 cm defect and you have used 8 cm mesh, no tacker, nothing. After few days, patient will come palpating the mesh in the scrotum, that what is this? Isn't it? Huge, complete inguinal scrotal hernia, mesh can migrate into the defect. You can feel the mesh from above also, right? It is migrated. Then rejection of the mesh is rare. You know, polypropylene rarely reject with the human body. But we are over-blaming. Whenever infection happens, seroma happens, abscess happens, we say that your body is very good. It doesn't tolerate the, you know, foreign things. So this mesh is getting rejected, we have to remove it. But actually rejection is rare. This is our fault, we have done some mistake, that's why infection happens. Another is bowel adhesion. As you told, if there is a small buttonholes, it is not properly, peritalization is not complete, if it is exposed, then it may be bowel adhesion also. So these are the complications. This is the testicular vessel, this is GFN, this is LFCN, this is the triangle of pain on the left side. So these are the complications which we must consider if you are doing the hernia surgery.